Today we celebrate Mass for the 32nd Sunday of Ordinary Time. Our procession this morning, friend of God, please rise.
Thank you. and lead us to life everlasting.
Give her the grace to live as a good child. We pray. entrance of the city. A widow was gathering sticks there. He called out to her, "Please bring me a small cupful of water to drink." She left again, and he called out after her, "Please bring along a bit of bread." She answered, "As the Lord, your God, lives, I have nothing baked. There is only a handful of flour in my jar and a little oil in my jar. Just now, I was collecting a couple of sticks to go in and prepare something for myself and my son. When we have eaten, we shall die." Elijah said to her, "Do not be afraid. Go and do as you propose. But first, make me a little cake and bring it to me. Then you can prepare something for yourself and your son. For the Lord, the God of Israel, says, 'The jar of flour shall not go empty, nor the jug of oil run dry, until the day when the Lord sends rain upon earth.'" She left and did as Elijah had said. She was able to eat for a year, and her son, and he and her son as well. The jar of flour did not go empty, nor the jug of oil run dry. And the Lord, as the Lord had foretold to Elijah, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Second reading, a reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Christ did not enter into a sanctuary made by hands, a copy of the true one, but heaven itself, that he might now appear before God on our behalf, not that he might offer himself repeatedly. As the high priest enters each year into the sanctuary with blood that is not his own. If that were so, he would have had to suffer repeatedly from the foundation of the world. But now, once for all, he has appeared at the end of the ages. He takes away sin by his sacrifice, just as it is appointed that human beings die once, and after this the judgment, so also Christ offered once to take away the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to take away sin, but to bring salvation to those who eagerly await him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Some 5 years ago, in 2019, I was ordained a priest. And after my ordination, the bishop appointed me to one of the parishes to go and minister to children. In the 2 months I had with them, I looked at the faces of the children, like those of Penelope, those of Bridget, as I was preaching. The children were not happy. And they were not getting along with my preaching. A friend of mine, a priest with whom I was working, asked me a question when we went back to the rector. Which facial expression do you want from the children? I told him, I want them to be smiling and happy. And he told me, if you want them to smile, you should smile yourself when preaching. It was so hard for me to do that, as it is still hard for me to do it now. To preach and smile at the same time. I many times admire Father Mitch when he's preaching, and Dr. Prince when they are speaking here, they are smiling at the same time, talking. How do you do that? But the message given to me by my Christian friend resonates very well with the reading you have had today. If you need something, give it up. If you need it, give it up. The readings of today teach us about generosity in a way that seems to be a little bit paradoxical. The reading presents 3 figures who gave up what they needed most. In the Gospel text, the widow gives out 2 remaining coins of hers. In the second reading, Jesus gives out his life for our salvation. And in the first reading, the widow of Zarephath gives out the remaining piece of bread and gives it to the prophet Elijah. And the pot of hers never goes empty, as the prophet prophesied. The widow in the gospel gave up her 2 coins and gained divine recognition, which is what we need for most of our lives. In the second reading, Jesus gives out his life for the salvation of us all as a sacrifice. And because he does that, St. Paul writes about him and says, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every other name, that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. Philippians chapter 2, verses 3 to 11. While talking about his sacrifice, Jesus himself said that if the grain of wheat does not fall into the ground to die, it will never bear fruit. There is need to do the sacrifice in order to have fruits of the sacrifice. If you need it, give it up. thing we know in the gospel text unique is not the amount of money she gave. Of course it was little, but the amount of sacrifice she made by giving up what she had. It's not about how much you give, but it's about how much sacrifice you make in giving what you do. If you need it, give it up. It is a human instinct to always give what we have. It's human to keep what you have. But experience shows that often what we give, we lose. And what we give up, we gain. It's also not uncommon among folks to hear folks say, "My husband does not respect me. My wife does not love me. My grandparents do not love me, do not listen to me." Often people say that. The message today is, if you need it, give it up. If you need respect, for example, it is a reciprocal thing. It should be you first to give it up. If you need a hug, for example, you have to give one up in order to receive. St. John Chrysostom said that where there is no love, always put love and you will find love. Let us take the example of the digestive system. As an example. Very soon we are going to have Thanksgiving. I've never attended one. But I hear that people prepare a lot of food. I hear for Thanksgiving. Imagine if the eyes focus on the food that is prepared and they don't release the food to go into the mouth, the body will starve to death. And if the mouth only feels the sweetness of the food and does not release the food to go into the stomach, the body will never gain from the food. It has to chew and swallow such that the food goes into the stomach. If it doesn't do that, then the food will decay in the mouth. The stomach also has to release the food so that the food is able to go out of the stomach and does its purpose. We are like the body in general. Whichever blessing we have must be used to develop and grow the body of Christ, which is the church, and we are part of that body. If we need to benefit from the goodness of the Lord who bestows great things upon us, we must become blessings and give out in generosity what He gives us in generosity. 2 years ago, as I was preparing, a parishioner came to me. I was saying 3 masses every Sunday. And so came to me and told me, "Father, you seem to be putting too much in the masses you say. You look stressed." I was looking stressed. "Is it not too much for you?" That was a question I never expected. But after thinking for a while, I responded, "I am refilled by the so many masses I say." It sounds funny, but true. humans. Let us fight, I said. The Lord be with you. And the Lord responded, and with the Spirit. You can imagine, I only say just one expressed wish to you, and you all respond, and I get as many of you respond. That is how generosity works. The Mass is the most perfect example of how generosity works. At the beginning, we say the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, and the Lord said, and with your spirit. I say Mass, and I receive so many. The Mass is that example. Even at the end of the Mass, we say, the Lord be with you as we go to bless, and all say, and with your spirit. And we are told, go forth, the Mass is ended, to go and bless others as we have been blessed. That is how magical generosity works. How magical the sacrifice, make the sacrifice once. After my ordination to the priesthood, we had a function at home where I said Mass. And I had some people, some family and friends were saying, oh, poor him, he's not going to have children. I overheard. In fact, people made it so great that to show me that I was making so great a sacrifice that I ever imagined myself. The following morning, all of them came and addressed me, good morning, Father. And I was responding, good morning to you. I was not going to have children, but I was having children. When I came here, all of you addressed me as Father. If you need it, give it up. Even if whatever I've said does not make any sense, remember this. If you need something, be the first to give it up. And we need the grace of God to do that until we come to the heavenly inheritance through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Tomorrow is a national holiday. In the 11th minute of the 11th hour on the 11th day of the 11th month, 107 years ago, there was peace declared. A peace that did not last, but we hoped that it would, and it became the birthplace of what we now call Veterans Day. And we are so grateful to all our men and women who serve in the armed forces or have ever served. And we do want to thank them today. Just want to acknowledge too that often enough it occurs during the same week as a national election. And this election carries a weight different than I've experienced in my life and maybe in your life. Some are saying, as consequential as ever. And part of why I think that is everything has been thrown into the light, and we remain yet such a divided country in almost every way. And that's not the prayer of Christ. So our work remains to bring unity out of that deep division. And one example that I had not thought about, but it's real, these American flags that we planted with such intention to honor our veterans have themselves been called into question because they've been co-opted by a movement that is not the gospel. And it reminds us that our work as citizens of heaven runs deeper than even citizens of these United States. So when the flag was designed at a time when many of our brothers and sisters were not free, and then this anthem got written, which the whole anthem is a lesson that we ought to be honest about, all the verses. But this flag, we claimed that it waved over the land of the free, and it did not and has not yet. So if we're gonna acknowledge the flag, and I think it's fair to do so, let's be honest about it and be committed to the work of fashioning a country that can live up to all those hopes that are expressed with some integrity. And so that work that lies before us to bring an end to division, an end of oppression, an end of racism, an end of inequity, an end of all of it. That's the work that's before us. And the men and women who serve in our armed forces serve a great purpose. Until there can be an end of war, we need you to stand there in the breach for us. And so we are grateful. So we will have all who have served, if you could please stand. And then as you hear your name called, if you can come forward into the sanctuary to receive a gift and a blessing. Okay, thank you.
Good morning, honorable members. Please stand. And when you hear your name called, please come up. And we're going to call all the names of our veterans and our heroes. Christopher Gordon, LTC, U.S. Air Force. Coisetta White, LTC, U.S. Army. Carol Wallace, SJT, U.S. Army. Corky Burr, Spec 5, U.S. Army. Beverly Mercy, SSG, U.S. Army. Valerie Howard, A1C, U.S. Air Force. Roger Moore, PO2, U.S. Navy, CBs. Andrew Thompson, Spec 4, U.S. Army. Dominique Garland, Spec 4, U.S. Army. Lee Lotz, U.S. Army. Marshall Brown, PVT, U.S. Marine Corps. Chris Englehart, SSG, U.S. Army. And Michael Delcon, SGT, U.S. Army. Also served in the U.S. Navy and the U.S. Coast Guard. Will all of our veterans please come forward for a blessing? All of our veterans, all of our veterans, please come forward.
Almighty God, we are grateful for the blessing. to risk their lives for our freedom, for our country that is yet to be what you have in mind for us. Pour out your blessings now upon them as they persevere in faith and in love of their neighbor and their country, all through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Now let us rise and present our prayers and petitions to God.
Response, loving God, hear our prayer.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
Our scripture today speaks of caring for the poor and destitute, for the struggling members of our society and city to receive the benefits and care they need. We pray.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
Tomorrow, our nation commemorates Veterans Day. For our veterans gathered here in prayer with us this morning, all veterans throughout our country, and those currently serving in our military, we pray.
Amen. God, hear our prayer.
That our recently elected officials be truly woman and man of integrity, high moral values, and honest civil servants, we pray.
Amen. God, hear our prayer.
For the citizens of war-torn parts of our world to soon be blessed with renewed efforts to secure peace, we pray.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
As we celebrate National Black Catholic Month, we lift in prayer our Black sisters and brothers who have contributed so much to the richness of our church, we pray.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
For the gift of strength and healing for our sick and infirm, we pray.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
We continue to hold in prayer this month our loving, faithful departed, especially those whose images are displayed in our sanctuary, and those whose names are written in our books of remembrance, and those not called, we pray. In thanksgiving for the prayerful presence of Father Mark, the Lighthouse Bowman Scholars, and the Spillman Gig Club, that God bless them and their endeavors as they return back to Atlanta, we pray.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
Pausing for a moment, we call to mind our prayer, our personal needs. We pray.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
Almighty and loving God, listen to the prayers and petitions presented here before you by your children, confident and trusting in your generosity and mercy that you will grant them through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty Father. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave this to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Thank you.
bread of life and chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.
Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Mitchell, our Bishop, and all the women and men who lead in your church. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the Blessed Apostles, with Saint Josephine Bakhita, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him, and with him, and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who say to your apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant our peace and unity in accordance with your word, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you already.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace. Thank you. alone takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are you called to the supper of the Lamb. The Barian blood of Christ keep us safe for eternal life.
Your mercy, and by pouring forth of your Spirit,
the grace of integrity may endure in those your heavenly power must enter. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Before our ministry spotlight, I'd like to acknowledge as we lift up our veterans tomorrow, we also offer a prayer of gratitude for their families who sacrifice greatly, especially when they're stationed overseas, especially when they're in harm's way. The families of our veterans also need to be lifted up. So today is our ministry spotlight is our maintenance committee, and Tom Mullen's here to share with us a bit. Thanks.
Good morning.
Good morning.
First of all, before I get into the description, I wonder if we have any members of the maintenance committee who are here today. I think I see at least one in the back. If you'd stand and be recognized. Great, thank you. The purpose of the maintenance committee is pretty simple. We work with the maintenance director to maintain and improve the physical facilities of our parish. We have had volunteers doing these sorts of things for probably since the beginning of the parish. But about 4 years ago, Ron Johnson, who was our maintenance director at that point, had the vision and the foresight to pull us together into a formal committee. Now we work with Rodney Jones, who has stepped in to fill Ron's shoes in a very able fashion. So what do? We shovel snow. We cut grass. We take care of the landscape. We clean up the church basement after it's flooded. We care for the electronic and internet needs. We change filters on the HVAC machine. We do all those sort of chores that are needed to keep our parish functioning well. We have about a dozen members of the committee. We meet on the first Saturday of every month at 9 o'clock over here at the parish office. We would welcome more members. You don't need any special skill. You don't have to be a technician or anything. You're just willing to work. So, if you would like to join, please see any members of our committee, or me, or Mr. Jones, and we'll put you to work. Thanks very much.
Go forth. The mass is ended.
Thanks be to God.
Our reception, our blessed Lord.